Good morning, everyone. I am joined with you this morning with a lovely, wise old friend. I'm sure you're all excited to meet him and the guy by his left in Subway. We are looking forward to a really amazing webinar this morning from as you can see, from David Tong. David is one of the wisest minds in the UNFCCC and also a lawyer by training, and he's going to be talking us through some of the critical issues that have developed over the last couple of years in the UNFCCC, so the UN climate negotiations. David Tong is a lawyer, a charity director, and a longtime climate activist. He coordinates the Fast for the Climate, which I recommend you check out as one of the coolest ways to get involved in climate action around the world. He coordinates New Zealand CAN, the Climate Action Network of New Zealand, and is on the board of Greenpeace New Zealand. So you can guess that he's got quite a range of understandings when it comes to UN climate change. Being a lawyer as well, obviously he has this unique legal perspective, which I guess reached out to him and asked if he could share some of that with us. So David's obviously kind of taken up, given us some of his time this morning, or this afternoon, where David actually is this afternoon, and he's going to walk us through what he's been giving as a bit of a lecture at universities around the world recently, and there was one lecture he gave at the University of Auckland, which I particularly wanted him to share with us. So if you go to the Facebook page and you want to follow on, you can, on the Facebook event page, you can see David's slides at http://www.slideshare.net/davidtong8/University of Auckland guest lecture. Or if you didn't get all that, you can simply wait on board and we're going to slide share the slideshow with you as David talks us through his amazing kind of collection of understanding. But before we do, let's get to know David a little bit better. You've heard his bio, but let's meet the person. David, how are you going today?
Hey, Chris, very well. I'm excited because tonight both I'm running this webinar and then about to see the New Zealand premiere of Naomi Klein's documentary, This Changes Everything. So it should be a pretty awesome evening with both those things happening.
Yeah, well, I hope so. I hope we can live up to the excitement of Naomi Klein. You've been at the COPs for a while now. When was your first ever UNFCCC COP?
My first COP was Durban, so the start of the whole negotiation process towards Paris back in 2011.
Okay, so you've been following then, I guess, pretty consistently since Durban, is that the case?
Yeah, I missed Doha, but I've been to every COP apart from that since.
Wow, so David's been to every one of the large UN climate change meetings at the end of the year since 2011. So what keeps someone like you passionate about continuing to go to these conferences and I guess passionate that you can be effective?
Well, I guess each year things have happened that have sort of expanded my campaigning reach. And even though I haven't always seen the progress I wanted to see in the negotiations, I've always seen an awesome youth movement and worked with incredible teams, including the Adopt Negotiator team and the Fast for the Climate team.
Great. And when you first started, because a lot of our viewers will be people who haven't been to a COP before, might not be kind of so up to date with all of the UN language, definitely know about their national struggles and their national kind of needs in terms of renewable energy and transitions and all of this. But for someone who hasn't been to a COP, what were you like the first time you went? Was it scary? Was it exciting? Was it kind of overwhelming? What did it feel like for you?
It was totally overwhelming, but I rolled into it having done my honours degree in law on New Zealand's emissions trading scheme. So I walked in thinking I knew everything. And then I discovered that what I thought I knew, I really didn't know. And so if you're going to COP or you're tracking the negotiations for the first time, it's going to be an overwhelming experience. But there are a lot of people on the ground and a lot of experienced old heads like Chris and Josh and others who'll be there, who'll be very happy to help guide you through what's going on. And for those who are going to be in Paris, if you see me there and have any questions, or if you want to hit me up on Twitter or via email between now and then, anything I can do to make it easier, let me know.
Perfect. So we're about to jump in and David's got this amazing lecture that he's going to share with us. I just wanted you to get to know him a little bit better. He does a lot of amazing things on his resume, but actually is a really nice down-to-earth guy in general. So I just wanted you to kind of get that sense that, you know, any one of you who's never been to a COP before, and who's kind of never experienced all of the UN climate change world. This was David only a few years ago, and since then he's really kind of dived in, and now he's at the level where he's, you know, one of the wisest kind of young people in particular in terms of climate change, and kind of the combination with law means that he has a pretty unique perspective. So he just said, if you want to follow us on Twitter, and if you do have any questions for David, you can either add them to the Facebook event page, so the Facebook event page where David has the event, or you can tweet at Call for Climate, so hashtag C-A-L-L for the number 4 climate. And we'll pass those questions on once David's finished our slideshow. But it looks like David's ready to go, and the slideshow is up. Also, if you want to, you can follow this slideshow, obviously, online directly from the Facebook event page link. But David, let's jump in if you're ready.
Okay, good to go. I've skipped the first 5 slides because they're all an introduction about me, and I think Chris has already done a better introduction than I can. The first thing I want to talk about is the big picture, which is the UNFCCC before the Durban process. So I'll quickly run through 5 key points that are the background for the negotiations over the last 4 years. The convention, the Berlin mandate, the Kyoto Protocol, the Bali Action Plan, and Copenhagen. These are important because these are the background for what we're doing. The convention was agreed over 20 years ago now, in 1992. I've heard people say that, well, Anjali said in 2011, and back in 2009, Christina Ora from the Solomons said, you cannot tell me you need more time. You've been negotiating for all my life. Well, if you're born before 1990, that's not true. If you're born after 1990, you are younger than these negotiations are. Negotiations towards the convention began in 1990. This means that some of the adopter negotiator trackers I've worked with are actually younger than the negotiations are. That's maybe explaining why there's so much legal context to all of this. The heart of the convention, though, is its principle of differentiation. The idea that all parties have a common shared responsibility to stop dangerous climate change, which is normally taken as meaning avoiding warming of 2 degrees or more, though there are arguments, and very much live arguments, that dangerous climate change begins before that, at 1.5 degrees, or even earlier. It's at least arguable that we're already seeing dangerous climate change. So all parties have a common obligation, but that obligation is also differentiated. Developed countries that have done more to cause the problem and that have more capacity to mitigate their emissions have a greater responsibility to do so. There are different formulations of this in the text of the convention. And some of those differences, I've got Articles 3, 1, and 4 of the convention up there on the slideshow, provide the genesis of the debates we still see today. Convention was this big umbrella. It's an overarching legal but not legally binding document. It's a document that sets a goal, sets some general mechanisms for how to achieve that. So we needed something a little bit more detailed. I'm just going to quickly jump off the slideshow so you can see me. Now, this is really common in multilateral environmental agreements. You've got the big picture, but then underneath it, you have a small, punchy, meaty, legally binding or not, treaty. Therefore, at the first COP, the first Conference of the Parties in Berlin in 1995, there was a need to create a negotiating process towards a treaty under the convention. So they launched what was called the Berlin Mandate. The Berlin Mandate divided countries in half. On one side, you had developed countries, the Annex I parties, that were specifically mandated to take commitments under the Berlin Mandate. On the other hand, you had the developing world, the non-Annex countries, cleaved with a strict firewall down the middle. Non-Annex countries would not take any commitments, neither binding commitments nor non-binding commitments. These negotiations got tough, and you'll see on the slideshow, which I quickly jump back to, that even on the 11th hour in Kyoto, a Chinese negotiator was feeling pressure from the US and said, in the developed world, only two people ride in a car, and yet you want us to give up riding on a bus. He was responding to a US proposal that all states, including developing states, should take on commitments. That proposal in Kyoto, however, failed. In the Kyoto Protocol, only Annex I countries took on targets, binding targets intended to bring their emissions, on average, back to 1990 levels. So it was a top-down regime. Quickly jumping back out of the slideshow, sorry, I'm going to have to quickly click on and off regularly throughout this. This led to a growing problem because the US did not ratify Kyoto. In some ways, that was foreseeable in 1997. The Bert Hagel resolution, a resolution of the US Congress, specifically stated that if President Clinton, back in the 90s, had ratified a binding emissions reduction target, Congress would refuse to sign on to it or block ratification. Therefore, when Bush was elected, unsurprisingly, a Republican president said, Congress doesn't want this, the people don't want this. I believe his words were that the Emperor of Kyoto had no clothes, and it took President Bush to see that. So, the US wasn't part of it, and no country in the developing world had targets. By 2011, only 15% of world emissions were covered by the Kyoto Protocol. So there's a growing sense that something more was needed. What more would that be? Well, 2005 began not negotiations, but informal discussions towards the possibility of having negotiations. And then in 2007, in Bali, they launched the Bali Action Plan, a plan to negotiate a new treaty that would either sit beside or replace the Kyoto Protocol. The Bali Action Plan, again, divided Annex I and non-Annex parties. So, to clarify again, by Annex I parties, I mean developed country parties listed in the convention. By non-Annex parties, I mean developing countries. Under the Bali Action Plan, all developed countries had to take on binding targets. Well, not quantified targets that could or could not be binding, but they had to be quantified. That means they were numbers cutting their emissions from a comparison base year. By contrast, developing countries were to take on nationally appropriate mitigation actions. I'm trying to cut through the jargon, so I won't say the word NAMA, but what these were not quantified targets. So peak years or any other mitigation action that a developing country could take on. And so hopes got huge. Negotiations continued all the way up to Copenhagen. And then Copenhagen, well, all I can say is, oh dear. A draft text leaked just before the negotiations, the so-called Danish text. Developing countries' reactions were bitter and angry. And we're seeing a similar echo of that bitterness and anger with reference to the chair's text that's been proposed for Bonn, where some developing countries, as negotiations begin this morning, are already reacting with strong criticism. But negotiations simply broke down. The trust gaps became too extreme to avoid. Turning off screen share again so I can talk. My girlfriend, Rachel, has been to every COP bar one since Copenhagen was there. Her defining memory of Copenhagen was standing in the queue outside the conference center, waiting to get in the snow. It was a conference with capacity for 25,000 people, where 40,000 people were given badges. Even the logistics of that conference were not going to succeed. So, after Copenhagen, in the words of the editor of the Climate Policy Journal, the ship of the UNFCCC, ship of the convention, was left holed below the waterline, rudderless and leaking. The convention was at risk of sinking. Some progress was made in Copenhagen. There was a thing you might have heard of called the Copenhagen Accord. And that's really important. Because the Copenhagen Accord, even though it was not a consensus agreement, it was not an agreement under the UNFCCC, laid an architecture of bottom-up pledge and step back. What does this mean? What it means is that at the 11th hour of Copenhagen, as everything was falling apart, President Obama and a few other key leaders of major countries, particularly Brazil, South Africa, India, and China, negotiated a new agreement between them, the Copenhagen Accord. That could not be agreed on by everybody in the negotiations. So only 130 countries signed on. And what they agreed that they would do was that they would each submit a target, come up with their own target, then report on their performance against that target. So where Kyoto started up the top and went down from the top, setting an overall umbrella goal for all Annex 1 countries of reaching 1990 levels in the first commitment period, the Copenhagen Accord was bottom up. Countries submitted their own targets with no overarching top-down mechanism on top of them. This became part of the UNFCCC mechanism in 2010. In 2010, the Cancun Accords implemented parts of the Copenhagen Accord, but not all of them. So when I rocked up at the International Convention Center in Durban, we didn't know what we were going to get. We were hoping still that there was a chance that there might be the agreement that we didn't get agreed back in Copenhagen. That didn't happen. Instead, negotiators of the world collectively agreed, effectively, to turn negotiations off, then back on again, like they were restarting a computer. They launched a new negotiating process. Three key points from that process. They agreed to come up with an agreement with legal force under the convention applicable to all parties to be agreed in 2015 and implemented from 2020. Unpacking each of those, an agreement with legal force leads to the debate we have now regarding what the legal form of the Paris Agreement will be. Even from the latest co-chair's text, we do not know if the agreement will be binding. We don't know whether it will be an agreement that is merely moral persuasion, non-binding, or an agreement that is binding. It could include partially binding parts. There's a long backstory to this with legal force wording that I'd love to tell you sometime. Ask me if you have a chance, but we're not going to have time in today's session to go through that. It's also an agreement to be agreed this year under the convention applicable to all parties. For the first time, comparing it to the Bali Action Plan and the Berlin Mandate, we don't have this two-part division between developed and developing countries. It's applicable to all parties. One size fits all. However, it is still under the convention, so somehow differentiation still exists. Finally, even though the agreement is to be agreed in Paris in just under 2 months, it will not enter force until 2020. That's why we have Workstream 2 on pre-2020 ambition. And Workstream 2 is always going to sit there in the background. Moving ahead from Doha to Lima. In the last 3 years, we've seen renewed debates about equity and differentiation. Even as early as the July Bonn session in 2012, just 6 months after Durban launched this new one-size-fits-all process, China and India and other developing countries campaigned for re-recognition of CBDR, Combat Difference Responsibility, in the text. That, however, gained its first recognition last year in the Lima Call for Climate Action. 2014 was the very first time since before 2011 that those magic words, common but differentiated responsibility, appeared in the text. Very importantly, we have built on the pledge and review architecture coming from Copenhagen with the Without Prejudice INDC process. What do I mean by without prejudice? Well, I'm a lawyer. In law, it's very common to make an offer without prejudice. What that says is, hey, I'm giving you this one chance. If you accept it, we agree. If you don't, I'm not bound by it. intended nationally determined contributions are offers without prejudice, both to the legal form of the Paris Agreement and without prejudice to what targets countries might take on. So they're a way of putting your cards on the table without committing yourself to anything. Originally, it was worded as commitments, but that commitment wording was dropped out in the Warsaw negotiations because drawing back onto the debates in Kyoto, drawing back to the debates around the Berlin Action Plan and the Bali Action Plan, China and India refused to be bound to taking on commitments. So contributions was agreed instead. Under this process, over the last year, each country, and over 100 countries already have, is stepping up and submitting their INDC, their intended nationally determined contribution. Not going to talk too much more about that, because I know that you climate trackers are pretty on point when it comes to the INDCs, especially in your own countries. However, what I want to stress is a bottom-up process that can inform the Paris Agreement, but does not necessarily determine its content. Looks like it's likely to, but that is still up for negotiation. Okay, flipping back to my slideshow. Now, actually, Chris, now's a great time for questions, if anyone has questions on what I've talked about so far.
Sure thing. I'm just kind of scraping through some of the questions. We've got some comments already saying that there's some people who really appreciate your pace and the way you're kind of going through things. So I guess that's a great place to start. There was also a question relating to you seem to jump into the INDCs really quickly. How do you see the relationship between the INDCs right now and I guess kind of the pledge and review that you mentioned that was a part of the previous processes?
So INDCs share a lot of common elements with the pledge and review process. Like a pledge and review process, they are bottom up. However, back in Warsaw, the intention was to create a meeting point between a top-down and a bottom-up process. As you'll see in the second half of this talk, the problem we're at now, especially with the co-chair's draft text, is we know pretty well, even though it's without prejudice, what the bottom-up part looks like. We don't know what the top-down part looks like. We, even with INDCs, as I'm sure most of you already know better than I do, don't have a common base reference yet. We don't have a requirement that all INDCs be submitted in the same format. We don't have common elements beyond some kind of mitigation commitment. So it becomes really hard to compare the different INDCs. This means that it will be difficult, but not impossible, to build that into an architecture for the Paris Agreement with some top-down elements. Any other questions, or shall I jump into the negotiations?
Yeah, well, directly linking to that, there was a question of what are the options for housing or anchoring? So you might need to break up what housing or anchoring means, but housing or anchoring the INDCs, will they be legally binding?
So there are a lot of proposals there. Some states have called for legally binding INDCs. So they want the treaty itself, the Paris Agreement, to be binding, but they also want the commitments made under that agreement to be binding. Other states want nothing to be binding. Even in this last co-chair's text, exactly what will be binding in this agreement is quite unclear. New Zealand, I'm sorry, I'm a New Zealander, proposed what is in some ways a realistic, if disappointing, compromise, where all states have a binding obligation to submit a target and to report against that target. However, achieving that target by the New Zealand proposal, which I think at this point pretty well reflects the likely landing point for the Umbrella Group's perspective, achieving the targets won't be binding. What also won't be binding by this proposal is how you report. By New Zealand's proposal, you can pick and choose your accounting standards. So something to hopefully push for in Paris is a set of meaningful common reporting elements. In an ideal world, I'd also push for binding INDCs locked deep into the text. However, given that the US is extraordinarily unlikely to ratify any such binding obligation, there may be good counterarguments against that, even though it's intuitively very appealing.
All right, Dave, that's a really interesting insight, and thanks for bringing in your unique experience as someone from New Zealand. We've got a lot of people who I think were really appreciating the way you kind of carefully had built up your momentum, and I'd love to jump into this second half if you're ready.
Okay, perfect. As you'll see when I share the slide, this is exactly the point when I do questions and a break in the lecture. And this slide here summarizes what I'm going to talk about for the rest of this presentation. A bit about the negotiations this year, and then identifying some key issues for Paris. I will say I wrote this slideshow before the last round of co-chairs text. So it is a little bit different from where things are at now, and I'll talk a bit beyond the slideshow if I get a chance. We've already talked about the INDC process. Only note is that the quote final deadline is in October, which is to allow, we've already had a civil society review put out, but to allow the UNFCCC to review it. Okay, January. In Geneva, the first negotiations after Lima, for the first time a draft text was adopted by the UNFCCC. In Lima, the intention had been to agree on a draft negotiating text. Consensus could not be reached, so the draft was just noted. In Geneva, the draft was agreed. Trouble is, the draft ballooned up to 90 pages. The intention had been to have the first half of the week, a process where parties could submit new text, then the second half of the week, a streamlining process where text was cut down and the treaty was shortened. What happened was there was the first part, but parties couldn't agree on streamlining. This means that the Geneva draft text contains the architecture of not one, but about five possible Paris treaties. In Bonn, and I've said ADP 2.8, the numbering has been redone, so that's now 2.9 and 2.10, but I believe, is it 2.10 and 2.11, with 2.12 coming up this week?
I believe we're in 2.11 this week, but I also believe It's just about as useless as anything I've heard come out of the UNFCCC.
Yeah, so for a long period, when I first made the slideshow, ADP 2.8 seemed to be extending infinitely. Then the UNFCCC and one of its incredible secretariat backflips decided to renumber the numbers. So sorry about the confusion there. We've had a bit of narrowing in towards an agreement. This agreement is perhaps captured in the chair's draft that was released a couple of weeks ago. Before that, however, there was a thing called the chair's tool, which was a mechanism the co-chairs of the ADP were using to determine what was in and what was out, and importantly, determining what was where. Because in Paris, we are not going to see just one agreement. We're going to see one treaty, which may or may not be binding, with annexes, which may or may not be binding. For example, it's likely that the INDCs may be attached as an annex to the text. In addition, we will see a COP decision. Every year at COP, the Conference of the Parties makes a decision. That decision will include the, quote, less durable parts of what is agreed, with the more permanent parts of what is agreed in Paris in the treaty. This becomes really important because the things that are put into the COP decision are subject to change every year, where the things that are in the agreement are locked in, probably for the next 15 or more years. But we're narrowing in towards an agreement. It's not perfect, but we're getting there slowly. Negotiating dynamics. This comes from my perspective. I'm a climate activist from a developed first world country. However, I've done a lot of stuff with the climate justice movement in the past. Traditionally, people have described the negotiations at COP along a single axis. In Copenhagen, the main criticism was an argument that there was a breakdown between developing and developed countries. So that's the horizontal axis on my graph here. What happened was that with the release of the Danish text, it was perceived by many, though not all. One developing country's negotiator, when shown the Copenhagen Danish draft text, grabbed it from a journalist, looked at it and said, "This secret text? No, this is the wrong one. I was working on a different secret text." So things are a bit more complicated than they can seem with any single axis. But traditionally, the Copenhagen era was perceived as a fight between developing and developed countries. This is the analysis that Daniel Badansky, a very senior American lawyer, uses. He argues that before that, however, there was a different ambition, a different dimension, a different negotiating breakdown between ambitious or cooperative states and states that lacked ambition. This was a fight between the two quadrants on the right, the two quadrants of developed countries. It was a fight between the US and Europe. This is very important. Kyoto's negotiating dynamics didn't hinge, according to Daniel Badansky, on a North-South front. They hinged on a fight between two developed, powerful global North power blocks. Then in Copenhagen, things changed and shifted 90 degrees. I argue that the real picture is much more complicated now. We have negotiations going across two axes, not one. We have negotiations where developed countries disagree with other developed countries and agree with some developing countries. And where developing countries often, though not always, disagree with each other. There are signs of G77 unity at times, but also signs of fighting within the developing world in the negotiations. So, here is an attempt, and only an attempt, at mapping from my perspective, my wholly subjective perspective, where I put countries on these two axes. So in the top left, you see the small island developing states and the alliance of small island states. Very ambitious, very cooperative developing states. The least developed countries, I should probably actually put higher up on the graph, are very much developing countries, generally quite ambitious. Some are extraordinarily ambitious. Then, controversially, I have put the like-minded developing countries below the center point of the graph. They are a developing country block comprising India, China, Venezuela, several other developing countries. Why I've put them below is that they have a quid pro quo mentality, where they have been very, very reluctant to take on the same kind of commitments as the developed world. And it's a sort of you move before we move dynamic. What I want to stress with this, though, is that in doing this, they have very strong principled basis, both in ethics, but also in the convention itself. The convention does impose the Annex 1 non-Annex firewall. So what they are doing is citing the convention. That means that even though in some ways they are lacking ambition domestically at times, though some of the INDCs are great, to be honest, and sometimes uncooperative in the negotiations, this is something that is wholly based, I would say, on the convention and its principles. On the other side of the picture, Europe tends to be relatively ambitious, though not nearly as ambitious as it should be, especially when you look at its INDC. But right down there in the bottom, and I'd say the EIG, the Ecological Integrity Group, with Switzerland and others, a bizarrely misnamed negotiating group, which doesn't always seem to be very ecological, would fall somewhere below Europe on this. But right in the bottom corner, the least ambitious and equal most developed group is the umbrella group. That's the old just counts. Japan, US, Norway, Canada, Australia, now Russia, and last, but unfortunately not least, my own country, New Zealand. We have consistently, I would say, been the most disruptive force in the negotiations. I'm just going to hide my face beside the slideshow while I finish talking about this.
You can't hide your accent, I'm sorry.
Nor can you, Chris, nor can you. But we have done some paradoxical things. For example, in Lima, I witnessed Todd Stern, the lead US negotiator, walk into the no food, actually I didn't witness, my girlfriend did. Todd Stern, the lead US negotiator, walking into the final closing plenary while loss and damage was being discussed, into a room where no food was allowed, casually eating an ice cream. A couple of years ago, the Australian government proposed that the only way Australia would take on targets would be if they were legally binding. Chris, you know your own country's domestic politics. Did Tony Abbott want a binding climate target?
Well, no. I mean, what we see in Australia is unfortunately a government that came into power quite recently and changed a lot of the feelings of a lot of Australians and actually the government beforehand. So the government beforehand was in a way quite progressive. It implemented the carbon tax. It joined the Kyoto Protocol agreement. It was quite actively pursuing a ETS scheme, so kind of a trading scheme of carbon credits with the European Union. And it very actively wanted a legally binding negotiating text. There's obviously a lot of ways when they weren't so positive, but definitely it was not a negative approach to the negotiations. Then what happened is, as many of you can probably relate to, there was an election and it was a conservative swing. And unfortunately, that conservative swing brought all hellfire to the party in Australia and brought in a very negative, administration. That administration has recently been changed by itself. Interestingly, in Australia, we don't seem to get to vote on our politicians anymore. But definitely, I think you were right, David, in that the administration of Tony Abbott, when he was in power over the last, two COPs, was a very negative one, one in which the Australian government, in almost everything that they could possibly do, would be undermining the legally binding nature of any agreement. But I guess they would be
handed. This is where I was jumping in on, because you talked about the government before Tony Abbott, the Rudd and Gillard governments. But Tony Abbott's government in 2013 proposed legally binding targets for everyone. As Chris said, there's no way Tony Abbott wanted to take on a binding target. So what Australia did was set an impossible threshold where no one would get a binding target, and so Australia refused to get it one. It's countries don't always mean what they say in these negotiations. Now, though, I'd say there are four key issues. And I hope that diagram of negotiating dynamics is helpful. Getting my head around the differences within the developed and developing world really transformed my understanding of COP. It's a much more complex picture than you often think of. I think there are four key issues happening. There are actually many others, like long-term goal, human rights in the text. But I think four key issues will need to be resolved in order for us to get agreement in Paris. Differentiation, legal form, something on finance, and loss and damage. There's a move in the INDC process towards self-differentiation, a bottom-up process where each country sets their own target. But the details of this are uncertain. Now, international law, it's at least arguable that common but differentiated responsibility is what's called a peremptory norm of international law. So a law that is binding on all countries, that informs all international law beyond the text of an individual treaty. However, what we're seeing is a clash between top-down and bottom-up models of differentiation. I described what these were earlier. In the current negotiations, however, we haven't worked out what the top-down elements will be. This leaves us with, from the Geneva draft, because it's important that the latest draft, the co-chair's draft, has not yet been agreed by the parties. It's a non-paper, not a draft agreement. It's a proposal from the co-chairs. There were five proposed draft differentiation models in the Geneva and earlier Bonn draft texts. Retaining the current annexes to the current firewall, creating new annexes, an emissions budget and an equity reference framework, or two pledge and review models. Retaining the current annexes is what China, India, and others have in the past pushed for. And superficially, it's great. There is a strong background for that in the convention itself. However, eight of the top 10 per capita emissions are countries that are not in Annex 1. And the US and others simply will not accept that. So there is a process where, alternatively, the US proposed we could draft new annexes. This could be great, depending on who goes where in these annexes. But politically, it's impossible. Russia, over 10 years ago, proposed simply amending the existing annexes in the convention. And that died after 10 years of negotiations. If it takes 10 years to propose an amendment to the annexes, we are not going to see new annexes in Paris. The small island states proposed an emissions budget and an equity reference framework. This seems ecologically sound, and I would love it if the world could agree on this. However, it's sadly diplomatically infeasible. We are not going to get this sort of pure top-down approach. So here we come to what I call Pledge and Review Plus, a meeting point between bottom-up and top-down models, where all countries propose something. They propose their INDC. That is somehow anchored or attached, annexed to the agreement. But then there is a top-down review process. That review process could be before 2020, so ex ante, or after 2020, ex post. And there are a lot of existing review models within the convention and without it that we could use for it. However, and this is where the co-chair's text is important, there is no reference to such a review in the co-chair's draft text. Instead, there is a 2018 analysis with not a formal process as yet. The details of the stock take, if the co-chair's text becomes agreed with these stock take provisions, would be left until 2016, leaving great uncertainty about exactly what the review, which has now been called a stock take, a less binding term, a less nuanced term in many ways, is used. So what we're possibly seeing is a collapse down to pledge and chat. Switzerland described this as parties know best their specific circumstances, responsibilities, capacities, and needs. So pulling it back out of screen share, what this means is that all countries would simply propose bottom-up without a formal top-down process. In practice, the co-chair's draft text falls somewhere between those two models. It will be a bottom-up INDC-based process if countries agree on the mechanisms laid out in the co-chair's text, which seems most probable, though not certain, with not a full review, but some form of stock take, and with review processes every 5 years or possibly every 10 years. We want 5 years. However, without more teeth, more detail in this top-down process, in the words of South African lawyer and negotiator Harold Winkler, this is very unlikely to achieve the convention's objective of avoiding dangerous climate change. What we're seeing here, in the co-chair's draft especially, is a very pro-umbrella group, very pro-developed country draft text. And so those LDCs, those small island developing states, they are going to need, and those least developed countries, they're going to need some quid pro quo. Legal form remains an issue in the text. We don't know what will be binding. We don't know. And the co-chair's text, I've got to be honest, as a lawyer, isn't especially helpful. And it doesn't have any kind of accountability process in it, really. But it's unclear from that draft text whether it will or will not be binding. We don't know what kind of treaty we're looking at. We are going to need to see, however, pulling back to the slideshow, some form of new financial commitments and hopefully a breakthrough or some progress on loss and damage if we are to have consensus on an agreement that looks like the co-chair's draft text. So, as a forecast for Paris, I think we're going to see a lot of fights coming out of the co-chair's text. One key issue is the presence of the long-term goal. There is a goal of stabilization of the emissions and of returning to either net zero or zero, 100% renewable or something we don't know yet by, quote, X year. That's going to need to get resolved or unfortunately dropped from the text. But what we're going to see is probably one of the two pledge and review models or some sort of blend between them with this new stock-taking concept. If we are to achieve the convention's goal, I think we need to strengthen the stock-taking back to a meaningful review. We're probably going to need some finance or some loss and damage mechanism or both to get a deal, but there's a real risk that at the 11th hour it's going to collapse back. It's something a lot like the co-chair's draft text, a pledge and chat mechanism. Okay, I need to rush off very soon to watch a movie, Naomi Klein's This Changes Everything, but I'm happy to take a couple of minutes of questions from Chris. Otherwise, tweet me, email me, message me, and I will see if I can give any more useful assistance.
We have had a couple of questions, David. So thank you so much for running, I guess, such an engaging webinar, but also a webinar whereby I think, for someone of myself who's had a bit of a history in the negotiations, and I was chatting with a few people who are kind of academics in these negotiations, and they really enjoyed the way you kind of connected topics, but also I think there's some other people who don't have that type of experience, and I think you went at a great pace that kind of anyone can join in and get a better understanding of things. So we did have a few questions, and they range from I think across those different audiences. So thank you very much. One question we had from Isatis is she said, talk about, quote, legally binding. How would an international enforcement mechanism be made? And would the agreement with legal force have some mechanism or structure for this?
So what we saw in the Kyoto Protocol was a legally binding agreement with accountability and enforcement mechanisms. The idea was that if you missed your target, you had to pay some kind of penalty, effectively. You would be subject to an enforcement process. And this is a very bad summary. I'm sorry. I used to be an emissions trading Kyoto Protocol guy, but that ended around about 2011. And then I began focusing very much on the Durban platform. So I'm really rusty on this stuff. But what's important is that we don't have a world court which goes into everything. We have the International Court of Justice, which has limited powers to countries that opt in. And so international treaties tend to roll their own processes for enforcement. It's not a top-down force with an international police force or anything like that. It's a system where you agree to a treaty. And of course, as Canada did in 2011, a week after sabotaging all they possibly could in Durban, you can walk away from the treaty and then you're gone. But generally, there are advantages diplomatically and economically to remaining in a treaty. And doing what Canada did, or even what New Zealand did, where we stayed in Kyoto but didn't take on a second commitment period, it's politically massively embarrassing. So countries pay their bills under the agreed accountability mechanisms. However, what is very important to note for Paris is that that may not be agreed in the Paris Agreement itself. The Kyoto Protocol didn't have its compliance regime agreed in 1997. The compliance regime was agreed in 2001 in Marrakesh, in the Marrakesh Accords, an amendment to the Kyoto Protocol. So we may see an agreement, if we do get a legally binding treaty, that the treaty will be a binding treaty, that there will be some compliance regime, but that compliance regime will be agreed at a later date.
Thanks, David. That's really interesting. And we had another question, I guess, linked to compliance. And this comes from one of our climate trackers, Beatrice Tulagan from the Philippines, who was mentioning that the Philippines recently came out with a really strong INDC. The actual number was a 70% reduction based on their business as usual projections. I guess there's a lot of confusion, especially within civil society in the Philippines, about how they get to that number of 70%. And her question is that there's going to be an election in the Philippines next year. And I guess it will be up to the next president, whoever that might be, to either continue or to, I guess, throw away this 70% reduction commitment. So do you think there's any regime or mechanisms, or I'm not sure what the legal term might be, that can ensure the strict coherence and sustainability of government's INDCs that they're submitting this year, given the fact that, as we know around the world, governments change and that new governments can either continue or to stop some of the policies that previous governments or administrations have implemented?
So that's a really huge question, because one way you could do it would be a Kyoto Protocol style binding regime like I just talked about. The other way, and the way that, for my sins, New Zealand's government has proposed, and the way that we're likely to see, is nothing more than moral pressure. The idea is that all countries make a promise, and if you then break your promise, it's embarrassing. I would love to have a process that is a bit stronger than diplomacy and international law by the power of embarrassment, but we don't want to underestimate the power of diplomatically losing face. It is possible that, say for the Philippines, climate finance could be contingent on continuing to meet the pathway towards their target. However, we don't want, for particularly for developing countries and climate vulnerable countries, too restrictive a regime. We don't want a regime that compromises developing countries' rights to development, or to use the words from the social pre-COP last year at Venezuela, the Margarita Declaration, the rights to the good living. There needs to be a process that allows flexibility to national circumstances, but also strongly encourages countries to really genuinely, meaningfully stick to their commitments. The Lima Call for Climate Action invited all countries to submit not just a numerical target, but a plan for how to get there. Most INDCs I've seen don't have much in the way of a plan. And so for domestic lobbying and campaigning, the question often is, where's your plan? Make a plan. Back to you, Chris.
Well, I definitely think you made some critical points, and that's a really great insight in terms of how there are some, I guess, legal mechanisms for ensuring compliance on the INDCs. But I think you're right in that we find that it does have a lot of, I guess, importance on civil society members from those countries keeping those countries to accord as well. Obviously, the climate finance would be a key kind of factor in whether a country wants to comply, but you also have the importance of civil society and being able to influence, and not only governments but larger audiences, and that's, I guess, a key aspect of the climate negotiations, but also a key aspect of the climate tracker program and all of the other efforts that are going on around the world. So I think it's very unique that we come to this segue after all of the discussion of the legal frameworks and forms and force and binding commitments of the negotiations, that one of the final closing points is that it's really up to people to keep their governments to account and to keep, I guess, working hard on pushing their governments to be as progressive and uphold their agreements as possible. You might be able to see behind me that there's a few people getting ready to do just that. And we're getting ready for a big day in Bonn. As you might know, if you're watching live now and you do have a bit of time. There's going to be a bit of a fireworks show in the first opening plenary of the Bonn Climate Negotiations here. As David said, it's 2.11 or 2.8 or 10 or whatnot. But there's going to be a lot of discussion over whether the negotiating text that we have at the moment is fair and is a proper kind of assessment of what different countries want to do and want to take forward to Paris. So David, you made a prediction about Paris. Do you have any predictions about what's going to happen in a few hours?
I think that the opening plenary will be explosive grandstanding, because opening plenaries often are. But what I suspect will happen is that the co-chair's text will be used as a basis for further negotiations, subject to some additions this week from parties. I really don't want to make predictions, but all I can say is that even without the co-chair's text and with the co-chair's text, with these two competing texts going on at once, we're in a better position than we were before Copenhagen, where this time 6 years ago, the text was 183 pages long. I said before that the Geneva text contained the architecture of 5 agreements. Copenhagen's draft contained the architecture of about 50. So I think that we've got good chances of getting an agreement in Paris. What I hope we can do, though, is push for a good agreement in Paris.
Well, you and me both, my friend, and I guess that's well and truly one of the most insightful deep dives into the negotiations that I've ever seen anyone attempt in a bit over an hour. And thank you so much for doing so. It's been absolutely insightful, and you've more than earned your ticket to Naomi Klein's movie. This changes everything. I believe that New Zealand and Australia might be some of the later, I guess, countries to screen that. So I think for a lot of people watching, you also have the opportunities to find This Changes Everything in, I guess, probably screened by advocacy groups and small NGOs around your country, so you can check that out. I know David's obviously very excited about watching his version in New Zealand, and I'll be kind of joining the Climate Tracker team in Bonn very shortly. We'll be keeping track of exactly what David noted, this new text and how it plays out. Follow us live on the Adopt a Negotiator site throughout the week. We've got a great team here, and we're going to be producing a lot of amazing blogs. Very soon, I'll also be introducing you to the Paris team. We'll have a blog about the Paris team, and we'll have a lot of great information that probably we'll get to test out some of David's predictions over the next 5 days, which, as you may know, are the last 5 days of negotiations before Paris. So David, thank you again. I hope you are able to keep track of the Adopt a Negotiator team and test out some of your own, I guess, predictions over the next few weeks. And if anyone has any further questions for David, you can reach out to David on the Facebook event page, on Twitter. Your handle is David...
David XVX.
And David, you also have a website as well that people can reach out to as well?
Yeah, my website's davidtong.co.nz, and my email address is, unsurprisingly, david@davidtong.co.nz. If you know my name, you can probably work out my email address.
Sounds like a few steps on Google and they're pretty quick to find you. So if the NSA can find you that easily, then I'm sure our climate tracking team can do the same. So thank you very much, David. It's been a wonderful way for me to start the morning, and I hope you've had a great afternoon.
Okay, thanks, Chris. Have a great time in Bonn.
See you. Goodbye, everyone.